Program is what is a class and what is an object and class declaration, how do we declare a class and what are the member variables of a class and what are the things and how do we plan a class. I mean, while writing a class, how do we write that and what are the properties or what are the fields that we need to define and what are the methods a class should support and basic functionality and all those things we will declare, we will talk about in the class declaration. And we also talk about creating objects. How do we create objects? What are the different ways of creating objects? Okay. And apart from that, we will also come across these methods. What are the methods and what exactly a method does and what exactly a method, what are the operations it can provide and how do we define a method, method declaration and all those things we will come to know in the methods. And next we will come across the what is a constructor and constructor overloading. Okay, now we will come across what is a class. Just class is the basic entity in the your object oriented programming where your entire OOPS concept it depends. Okay, according to the Sun Microsystems Java docs, a class can be defined as a blueprint from which individual objects are created. It describes the state and behavior of the entity. So in the normal terms, I can say that a class is just nothing but an idea. Okay, first of all, you want to do some operation or some work or some activity. So how do you do that? Before doing that, you will put things on paper. For example, if you want to construct a house, okay, before constructing, you will have a plan of the house, okay, that is called your construction plan, okay, building plan and all those things. So in that you will define what all the things that you are going to build. I mean, where will be the entrance and where will be your parking gate and everything will be defined in the same way. In the same manner, if you are doing some in the software field, if you are doing something over here, okay, before doing so you need to define what all the operations it has to do. For example, I want to have a student class. My use case is just nothing but the requirement. Okay, my requirement is that when I want to have a student information of all the colleges. Okay, so what are a student generally has? What all the information or properties a student has? It's in a generic way. Okay, not specific. Okay. Normal, I want to define a student class, okay, so that whenever I invoke the particular class, I will get all the information of the student in the same manner so that I can process that particular information and all those things. So think about in that perspective. Now on your screen, I'm having a, just forget about all the syntax and all those things, okay. I will be going into the syntax and all those things in detail after that. Just this is a student class. Okay, public class student. Okay, this is a general class. Okay, how a class structure, how a structure of a class looks. Okay, forget about all the keywords, syntax and everything. Just public class student. This is how you need to define a class. Okay, forget about what is public, what is class and everything. Okay, for the time being. So now I am defining a student class here. So what exactly a student has? It has a student has some properties and apart from having some physical properties, he can perform some actions. Okay, those actions are just nothing but your methods. So what are the activities he does? We can say those are the actions, and these actions I can say it as an in software terminology and in Java terminology I say them as a methods. Now just going through the what are the what are the physical features. And after age, apart from name, you will have some age. Okay. And apart from that age, you will be certain height and you will be having certain weight. Okay. These are some of the physical properties which are common to every student. Okay. Now, what are the actions he does? What exactly a student does? Student is just nothing but who studies, okay, and who goes to a college. He is called a student. So this is your basic functionality. So I am defining it as a separate method. Okay, this is called one action, public void study. Okay, now public void play, he plays certain things. Okay, he plays certain things. So these are all called a class. These are this entire things, the properties of a physical student, the properties of a student. Apart from that, the actions of a student. I am clubbing together this in a single class so that this entire thing can be treated as one entity. So this type of things is called a student. Okay, I mean this type of things is called a class where we define is particular things. Now it describe in the definition I said that it describes the state and behavior of the entity. So what exactly the state means? State is just nothing but what are the parameters it is holding at the time. For example, if I take the information of a student right now, his age is different, his height is different, his weight is different. So state is just like nothing but what is the values that is holding at that instance. Okay, now what exactly the behavior of the entity means? Behavior is just like when he is a student, he studies, he plays, he walks, he reads, he participates in the competitions, he participates in the technology things, and all those things he does is called a student. Now that is called your behavior, how the behavior. So this is called a state and behavior of the entity. So what a class does means it gives a state of an entity, and at the same time it tells us the what is the behavior of that class. Now student class tells us that the student behaves in a such a manner that he the behavior of the student is that he studies and he plays and he participates in technology things and different competitions. Okay, that is called the behavior of a entity. Now for example, I can take another example of a student. Now what exactly other example of a class, how do we do how the student looks, right? Now we will see how a employee class looks. Okay, what exactly an employee class does. Okay, I'm just opening my Eclipse editor, Java editor, which is a Java editor. I'm just defining things. Just forget about how I'm doing. Just concentrate on the what I'm showing. Forget, you may be, this is quite new for you. So don't look at the keywords and syntax and all those things. I just want to define what exactly a employee class does. Okay. Now, this is how your class structure looks initially without any member variables. I will let you know what exactly a member variables are called. So this is called your employee class. This is the name of your class. Okay, employee is called the name of the class. At the same time, how do you know that this is a employee class? So that we need to use a class keyword before the name of the class. Okay, forget about this public. This is called access specifier or access modifier. Okay, I will let you know this in the next session. Just forget about this public. Okay, so this is how I define a class, public class employee. Now as I said, a employee or any class just gives us the parameters. I just said that it is a state and behavior. So a state can be defined as a properties of a class. Okay, and behavior is just nothing but what exactly the employee class does. It is just nothing but what are the actions it does, employee. So think in a perspective, employee. So what all the what all the parameters or what are the features an employee class does. So initially an employee will have some name thing. So name is just nothing but it's a set of characters. The set of characters in Java is called string. So name is just nothing but string. So define a name. So this is your data type. Okay, I think you people might have gone all those things. What exactly string, int, double, float will be there. So E has a name. So which is of a type string. Next, we will come to know what exactly is employee number. So everybody, even when you are in the college, you people will be having some roll number and admission number and all those things. In the same way, every organization gives an employee an employee ID. Okay. So which is, for example, it can be anything. Okay. It can be numerics or alphanumeric. For the time being, I'm assuming that it is a integer. Okay. It's a numeric. So employee number. Numeric means in Java, we will call it as int. Okay. Next. He has a name. He has an employee number. And apart from that, he can be clubbed into different departments. Okay. For example, take some government organization. He is into some scientist department. He is in, so for example, central government. He is working from some CSIR units. He has been joined and he is into the R&D department, research and development organization. So that is a different department. If he is into the some other department, he can be differentiated from other departments. So he belongs to some department. Okay. String department. Okay. At the same time, he is an employee. He will be earning some salary. So which is of a numeric value. I can say it as a salary. Okay. So these are some of the things, any employee, some properties, generally we will call it as all properties of a employee, any employee. If you take any employee, any organization, this is a common to any organization. Okay. Not specific to some organization, whether private or public, everything. Okay. These are some of the features or some of the parameters of every employee class belongs. Okay. There are specific to the employee. Now, these are the enough. We will be taking only five, and these are the certain properties which are common to any employee entity. Now, what an employee does, like a student reads or a student studies, and what an exactly an employee does. An employee is just nothing but who works in any organization. Okay. He does certain certain operations. For example, I am taking an vital parameters of a power plant. Okay. Apart from that, what else he does? He reports to the superior officers. Okay. After calculating or after fetching the information from the different systems of the power plant, he has to report these parameters to the higher authorities. Okay. He has to report to higher management. Okay. This is the another operation he has to perform. So this is another method of an employee. Okay. Okay. So this is specific to an employees in the power plant. Okay. What all these things represent to us? It's his work. Overall, generally, what exactly he does in a power plant, or what exactly he does in his own organization. So I can say that public void work, to be in more generic way, I can say that public void, he works for an organization, whatever may be the work. Because why I didn't give this in the initial stage is that I just want to give some specific employee functionalities. Okay. So in the same manner, this is just nothing but he works in an organization. He does certain operations, which we can say that this is called a work. Okay. He works. Okay. In the same manner. Now, if you see this, a structure of an class. Now you can see this. Okay. These are called parameters of a class. And this is the actions of a class. So by seeing this, I mean by observing this employee class itself. By observing this employee class, okay, what we can assume, I mean, you will get some idea what exactly this employee class. Okay, employee has certain name, employee number, he has a department to work, and he is earning some certain salary, and he has a age, and all those things you will come to know, and you know what exactly he does in the work. You can define is what exactly he does. He monitors, he reports, all those things you can hear. Okay, so by seeing itself, you know what exactly an employee does. Mean this is called a blueprint. Okay, this is specific to an entity called employee. So we are capturing all the information of an employee. Okay, in the same manner, I have a student here. I have a student who has certain student roll number, name, age, and what are the actions that are being done by a student. So as part of this entity student, I can define that by seeing the student itself. I can say that this class does some operations. So what a student has done, that's the reason we called it as a blueprint. Okay, by seeing the class itself, you will come to know what is the state and what exactly the behavior of this class is going to done. Okay, this is called a class. Okay, now as I said, note on that, class is a logical entity. What exactly a logical means, it doesn't exist, okay, unless until it is instantiated. Okay, I mean created an object. Now we will come to know what exactly an object, and in the same manner, you will have, as I said in the initial discussion, a class is just nothing but I can relate it to a plan of a building. Okay, you have a plan on the building, you have a plan of your building on the paper, but it doesn't exist outside. Okay, in the same manner, that's why we will call it as a plan of a building, as in a blueprint of the building. Okay, in the same manner, the class is just nothing but it is a blueprint, okay, of an objects which define some certain characteristics and behavior. Okay, so you just correlate the things in the more easy way. Okay, now as I said, it's a logical entity. So how do you materialize the class? I mean, how do you use this entity class that is being used with the creation of an object? How do you have a plan on the paper? Now you can't use that paper. Okay, you have a building plan on your paper, but can you stay on the paper? I mean, can you stay in that house where the paper, where your plan is there on the paper? No, right? You have to build the house and you have to materialize, which is called, in the real world, we will call it as an object. Okay, we will call it as an object. You do not, we need to make it as an, in the real world, we need to put it on the earth, on the surface, and you need to build the things. In the same manner, how do you materialize the class is just nothing but your object. So an object is just nothing but an instance of a class. I mean, in the OOPS programming language, we will call it as a software bundle of variables and methods. The methods are related to the variables. Okay, it's not something. I cannot have a method here called work. Why? Because a student doesn't work. The main property of a student is just nothing but he has to study. In the same manner, I cannot have a method called public study, public void study here, because this is not the functionality of a employee. He has to work ideally here. Okay, I cannot have this method here because it doesn't show the characteristics of an employee. Okay, it doesn't show that what actions he has does generally. Okay, the main functionality of an employee is that he has to work in an organization and he has to work for the welfare of the organization. So he can't study over here. Okay, the main functionality is here. In the same way, I cannot have a method called public void work year, because student doesn't work. The main functionality or main characteristic of a student is to study. Okay, he shouldn't work actually. We cannot make a 10th class student or intermediate students to work. Okay, so he doesn't show his character. That's not the proper way. Okay, so in the same manner, that is called, that's where this term called related methods. It should be related. It should define what exactly he does. It should show what are the characteristics of that particular class. Okay, now as I said, an object is just nothing but an instance of a class. What exactly an instance? When I'm saying that, if I take for example, if I materialize this subject student class, I mean if I create an object of your of all the students sitting over there, okay, now you will have a student number, you will have a name and age at this instance. If I am taking now, means this is the parameters of this time. If I take the same parameters after 1 year, it will have different names. Maybe name may not be changing. Okay, your age will be changing, your height will be changing, your weight will be changing, all those things will be changing. Okay, your characteristics, your physical properties might change. Okay, in the same manner, that is called an instance of a class. Okay, what exactly instance means? What are the properties and a class is holding at that time is called an object. Okay, in the real world, everything is an object. Like we are all objects. Okay, we can be treated as a one entity called human being objects. If you take the vehicles, those are called vehicle entities. If you take animals like dog, cat, tiger, those are animal entities. If you take any your stationery like pen, paper, like and pencil, each one is an entity. Each can be defined as a different class, because pen has a different things. Pen, if you can write, a pen has a class, right? What all the properties a pen will have? It has certain height, it will be certain color. A pen has a certain color. What is the type of writing? I mean, whether it is a red pen or a blue pen, that is called the color of a pen. And what all the things a pen has does, like it writes. Okay, that is a major functionality of a pen. If you take a dog, right? Dog has a certain breed, dog has a certain character, a dog has a certain color, and dog has a certain height and weight. It has a breed, different things. What are the properties? What are the actions a dog does? It barks, okay? It barks and it gives protection to the house where it, where it guards. Okay, those are the certain properties I can define. Now, every object is of a different type. Now, you might be understanding now, you will get idea what exactly an object slowly, slowly, okay, not immediately. You know what exactly a class is. Now, object is just nothing but an instance of a class. Instance is just nothing but assuming it, putting it on a real world. Okay, putting it on a, like you have a map, building plan, and you are making it as a building structure. You started constructing in a house. That is called an object. Okay, where if you have a map, if you have a plan on the paper, that is called your class. If you start constructing a house, then it became an object. Okay, in the same manner, I have a class. If I started started using it, then I can use it only in a way called object. I can use it as an only as an object. Okay, now in the software terminology, now forget about the real world and all those things. In the programming and in the programming world or in the software terminology, what exactly a object contains? Object contains certain parameters or variables and methods. As I said, what exactly the variables are? These are all properties, as I said, characters and all those things. I mean, nature properties of a physical properties and all those things comes under your variable thing. And related methods. This related methods. What exactly? I will just give an overview of a method. Method is just nothing but a class or an object exposes its action using its method. I mean, this particular object, or for example, this student object exposes his action by using this method. if you invoke this study method, I mean, you will come to know what invoking a method and all those things in the say after this session, I mean, in the due time. This is if I invoke this method, I will come to know this particular student is studying. I know that what exactly the action is performing. All those information I can be known by exposing, I mean, by invoking the methods of a class. So a class or an object exposes its actions using this method. Okay. Like I said, a study and play are the methods. In a student or a work in an employee class, those are the methods. And using these methods, a class or an object are exposing their actions that are being performed by this particular entity. Okay, so you understood what exactly an object. Object is just nothing but instance of a class. Now, there is a syntax, okay, to define a class. Now, public class, student, and all those things, this is called a syntax. Okay, how to define a class. In the same manner, how do I create an object? How do I create How do I declare an object? Okay, those things are just nothing but, okay, there are n number of ways to create an object. Okay, there are n number of ways. For example, you can see here, student one is equals to new student. Okay, this student one is called the object. One of the object of the student. To be more specific, I will again going to my editor. I will show you that now. Okay, I have a class employee here. Okay, now I want to create an object for this. I can use this employee class only after creating the object. Okay, the things can be materialized with the objects only. Okay, how do I create? First, I need to have a public static void main. I think you people went through all this public static void main and all those things. This is the starting point of your execution of your Java program. Okay. Okay, I'm just creating an object using a new operator. Okay, this is called new operator in Java. This is a keyword. Okay, you know what exactly a keyword is, not right? You cannot be used. I mean, it's not a normal like age, sal. It's a keyword. You cannot use wherever you want. Okay. Okay. Now I created an object called even. Okay, using new operator. Now this is even is an object. Now if I want to create another object, sorry, E2, I'm creating another employee object, which is E2. Okay, now even is an object of employee and ET is also an employee object. Now how do you see this in the real world? Generally, even is called a reference variable. Reference means what exactly it refers. How do I say this means in the software terminology? You have an address to an every house. Okay. For example, there is some 12-10-20 something is there. Okay, that is an address. Okay, what exactly it references? It refers to a object. I mean, it refers to an house, original house. That's called a reference variable. In the same manner, E1 and E2 are the reference variables or references to the objects. Okay, are called the reference variables of an object. E1 and E2 are called the references of the object. Now I can use these references to access the employee object. How can I? Even now, if you can see this API, it will give. This is possible with the editors only, not with your notepads. Now see, I can access my age. You can see these things, because even is an employee reference variable, so it has an access to all the variables of an employee. You can see the variables: age, department, employee number, name, salary. Forget about this clone and equals and all those things. I will let you know these are the object. I mean, these are the methods inherited from the object superclass. Okay, every class is a subclass of an object superclass. Object is the superclass of every Java class. Okay, we will come to know in the inheritance concept all those things. Okay, now if I give this even, which is an employee reference variable, has access to all the parameters: age, department, employee number, name are the parameters of a class, and salary is also parameter of a class, and you can see the work. Okay, even work is also there, which is a method of a class. Okay, if your work will be down, okay, it will be, the order will be in the alphabetical order. Okay, in the, and moreover, first reference variables will, I mean instance variables will be shown. These are all up to salary is an instance variable, and after that everything is method. Your work is with W, right? So it is at the bottom. So this reference variable, I can invoke this one. Okay, or I can also invoke is salary. I can assign some value. Okay, like this I can materialize. If I say this, for example, I will give an example now. Department is a string. Okay, department is in a string, that's why I enclosed in the these things, quotations. Again, employee number is an integer. In the Eclipse or in the editor, you can see beside this, it will gives you the data type also: age, int, to which it belongs, employee class; department, string, to which class it belongs, employee; employee number, what is the data type, int, and which class to it belongs to, employee; name, what is the data type, string, and which class it belongs to, employee; salary, which is the data type of the salary, int, and to which class it belongs to, employee; and clone is a method, to which class it defines. Actually, this is the data type of a this is called your reference type. I mean, what exactly it gives, return type of a method. Okay, I will let you know what exactly return type of method, and which class it belongs to, object. All those things you will come to know here. Okay, name, again it is a string, some x, y, z name. Okay, so I define everything here. Okay, now you can see these things here. These are just nothing but a properties, I mean just nothing but a variables, which doesn't have any values. Okay, which doesn't have any values. Now I am giving some values over here. E1.age equal to 25. This is called instantiating an object. I mean, applying some values to the variables of an object. Okay, in the same manner, you can give for E2 also. Everything you can define like this. Okay, You understood what exactly an object and how do you instantiate an object. Now, if I say system.out.println, okay, this is a statement. I know you people might be knowing this, to print the values at the terminal, I mean console. Even dot age. Now I can know what exactly an age is of an even employee. Okay, this is called an instance of an object. Now if I take this instance at this instance, if I take now this, if I consider this even, now even is holding all these values for all these parameters. Okay, this is called an instance of an object class. Okay. Now, in the example, I just want to show that. Now you can see this, how in the same manner you have employee one, employee two, and employee three like that. I created an employee student object. This is how you were. Now here I created four student objects using new operator. Okay. Now these are the values that are each student object is holding. These are the different objects. Okay. Now this is a main class structure. Now using that class, I have created four objects. For each object has its own state and behavior. That's what I said. Okay. State is just nothing but what are the values currently it is holding. Here age is 21, 20, 21 and 22. Different ages are there. Okay. They are not common. In the same manner, what they have, the name is XXX, XY, AA, XYZ. Okay. The object is same, but the values that is holding currently are different. That is called an instance of an class. Okay. This gives some idea. Just take down this example. Now after this we will be going to how does a class, I already showed you, but we will go in depth how a class declaration needs to be done, what are the different keywords and what I mean how exactly the things will be there, and those things we will come to know. Okay, class declaration. So we were talking about what exactly a class is and how do we instantiate a class which is called an object. We were going through all those things. Now we will and I was just telling you about that while declaring student employee class, public class employee, forget about class and public keywords and all those things. Now it's a time to learn what are those things exactly, what is the syntax, how do we define those things, what exactly the meaning of each keyword. Those things we will come to know in the class declaration. So again we will go to the, this is one of the way. The first thing is just nothing but public class, my class. This is a plain class. Okay, this is a plain class. Just my class doesn't have any relationship with its super class, or it's not implementing any interfaces. You will come to know what exactly the interface is, what is a super class in the inheritance concept. We will slowly learn in the subsequent classes. Okay, so for the time being, don't go into that. I mean, I will not even tell you what exactly interface. Just see the syntax. This is one syntax. Just take down this. Okay, this is one of the declaration types. Okay, this is one way of declaring a class. Okay, this is one way. This is a plain type. I mean, I can say this is a public class. My class is just nothing but your plain declaration of a class. Now, second one. Public class, my class, extends my super class. and also implements my interface. This is the another way. Okay, this is another way of declaring. Maybe you might be knowing, I mean, forget about interface. Extends is just nothing but inheritance concept. Okay, it is extending the super class. I mean, it means that my class is a subclass of my super class. Okay, in C++, you know this, I think. My class is just nothing but a subclass of my super class, and this implements my interface is a specific feature of a Java. We will come to know that. Okay, these are the two different ways. I mean, I can even split this also. So these are the generic, I mean, basic things how a class can be declared. Now we will go to the editor. Okay. I was saying that this is a class declaration, public class employee. After that, you need to open the parenthesis, and everything should be there in the parenthesis. This is, you can see this is the closing parenthesis of that. The corresponding closing parenthesis is this one. You will have a cursor over here. If I roll here, it will be shown here. The corresponding, it will show your corresponding open parenthesis here. See, it's showing here. For example, if I open here my public static void main also, if I point here, if my cursor is here, it will show its corresponding closed parenthesis. Okay, you need not worry about all this closing and all those things if you use this Java editor. Whereas if you use a Notepad and all those things, plain editors, where you need to take care of all those things. Okay, now public class employee. Okay, and open parenthesis, and this is closed parenthesis. This is how I define. This is normal Java class declaration. Okay, how this is normal, a plain Java class. Now, as I said, every Java has a fields, like we will call it as a parameters. Generally, we will call it as a parameters or fields, methods. These are called fields and methods. An employee class has a fields and methods. Now, what are the fields and methods means? These are the fields and these are the methods. Okay, this is also method. Okay, this is a method. This is also, we can call it a main method. Now, for example, assume that it wants to extend some of the super class. My super class, this super class is not there, that's why you will get some error. Okay, object is there. Every class in a Java extends the object, inbuilt. Now it means that public class employee extends object. It means that this object class is super class of employee object. Object class is super class of employee. Okay, or it can be either way. okay, or employee class is subclass of object class. Okay, I can say this also. Okay, this statement signifies this. Both statements are correct. Okay, object class is superclass of employee class, or I can say employee class is subclass of object class. Now, even it can implement n number of interfaces, implements serializable. Serializable, I need to import, I think. Okay. Just forget about what exactly it is. Serializable or clonable. Okay, this is another syntax, implements serializable, or it can, a Java class can implement multiple interfaces. We will let you know what exactly an interface in the inheritance concept. Just for the syntax purpose, I'm showing how can this is entire class declaration. Okay, a class can be declared like this. This is everything is a class declaration. It is extending an object class, and at the same time it is implementing serializable and clonable. Okay, this is where this entire things, by these things it is achieving inheritance feature. Java achieves inheritance feature with these statements. Okay, we will I will explain in detail about this extends and implements keywords in the inheritance concept. Now, this is, as I said initially, this is called the name of a class. Okay, this is called a name of a class, and to identify whether it is a class or something, we need to suffix, and this is called access modifier. Okay, this tells us that whether this class can be accessed or not. What exactly an access modifier? Public is called access modifier. Public is called access modifier. This is called access modifier. What this access modifiers are? What are the different types of access modifiers? Public, private, protected, and default. Okay, default is not a keyword. If I do not use anything here, then it is called default. Okay, default is not a keyword, so that I can use here. I cannot use default as this, like this, because show, you can see here it's showing error. Okay, default is just nothing but if I do not use any access specifier before class keyword, then it is called default. Okay, public, private, protected are, and default are the different access modifiers or access specifiers which can be used before the class. Now I can use private. Okay, I can use protected. Okay, now generally these things tells us that whether this class can be accessible from anywhere. If I use this public, I can access this class from anywhere, from any package or from any network. Over the network I can use it. Okay, from any package I can use it. This again we will come to know this access modifiers in the packages. Okay, in the packages class there is a in the after two sessions you have a packages class where we will be discussing in detail with examples on this access modifiers. Just we have a time, this is a time where you need to learn what are the keyword that can be used in front of a class. So those are public. Public means if you use this public, the class can be accessed from anywhere from the world. Okay, private has a, if you have more restrictions to use that class, means except the member except the methods, instance methods of this class, if you want to use only those instance methods, then you need to go for private. If you want to have combination of these two, public and private, okay, then you need to go for a protected. There is a certain limitations if you do not use any if you do not use any access specifier, which is called default. Okay, there is a slight difference between protected and default. Okay, those things we will come to know in the packages class. It's a big thing, we need to go in detail about each access specifier. Okay, just take down that these are the four access specifiers of a class which can be used in front of a class keyword of a class during the declaration. Okay, so while planning itself, while declaring your class, you should declare this, whether it is a public or a private or in a protector or a default. Okay, so you while programming itself, you need to understand whether this needs to be accessed from everywhere or whether we need to safeguard at this particular class and all those things. Now everybody wants to know their name, employee number, department, but everybody do not want to know their reveal their salary. Okay, so I can use it as a private variable also. Okay, private, so that nobody not everyone can access this private this integer. Okay, these things you will come to know. I just give an example to understand where to use this private, because people do not want to reveal their salary and some certain things that they do not want to reveal. So in that case, I can go for a private access specifier. So this is how you declare your classes. Declaration of a classes. There are two methods I showed. This is the plain one, and the another one is the implementation of a serializable. Extend superclass and implement serializable and clonable. Those are some two important interfaces. Okay. This is done. Next. What are the different now? We initially in the student class we have seen creating an object using new keyword. Okay, I was if you can see here, I have specifically mentioned here creating student objects with new keyword, new operator. I explicitly mentioned here. Now this is one of the way to create an object of a class. This is one of the way. There are four ways how to create an object. The using new keyword is one of the way. Now before that, I will let you know what exactly how there are. There are different methods. There is a certain naming for this statement. Now if you can see this student one means the variable. I said that this is the student one or E1 in case of employee class E1, and in case of student one are called the reference variables of a class or an object. Okay, now you can see this student one, which is in bold. Okay, this is called declaration of a class, declaration of an object. Okay, declaration on an object. If I use a new keyword, then it is called instantiation. If I use a new, then it creates an object. It creates an object. Now after new, I'm using certain thing here, student closed brackets. Okay, I mean this is a method. It invokes the object type. What is the object type here? Student. It invokes an new, creates an object. It assigns that object type after this statement. That is called, it is initialization. Okay, new creates an object, but it assigns the type after this statement. Okay, so this is called declaration, instantiation of an object of a class. Just take down this. Okay, this is very important, because in the polymer, in the inheritance concept, we will come to know the reference variables and all those things. How do we achieve overriding and all those things? We will again discuss this in declaration, instantiation and initialization there. You need to understand what, as I said, student one is just nothing but a reference variable of a student object, student class. Okay, and you can see here, new is creating an object of type student, which is called initialization. Instantiation, initialization. Just take down this. Okay, this is very, very important. This is, as I said, this is one of the way of creating an object using new keyword. We will see what are the other different ways to create an object. So these are the four different ways you are to create an object. This is the first one, is just nothing but till now we are using for employee and student. Okay, using a new keyword. Okay, now ST is just nothing but object of a student class. Now after that, you have a class dot furname, using class dot furname. This class dot furname is just nothing but, it's a factory method. We will come to know what exactly a factory method in subsequent classes. Do not bother about that. Just take this syntax. Okay, class dot furname, and using class dot furname and new instance method. This is another way of creating a method, I mean object, and using cloning method also. I was showing you right over here. You can see here. Event dot clone. Okay, you can see this particular method. This is the same method. Okay, event dot will give. This is the same method. Okay, I will let you. We will explain this in detail. Okay, I was referring the same clone method. I just want to show you the clone method, how this is another way of creating clone method. Cloning is just, this is the same cloning that we use in the general world. I mean, creating a, you know how cloning animals and all those things, right? This is the same methodology they use in the software terminology. There is a different types of cloning, deep shallowing, deep cloning, shallow cloning. We will discuss this in the after sessions. This is another, using cloning, we can also create a method of, I mean, object of a class. Deserialization, using deserialization also. We'll let you know in the IO what is exactly serialization and Java IOs, input and outputs. We will go through this, what exactly is serialization and deserialization. We will go through in the Java input and IOs. Okay, the general methods that we use as part of the creating object is this new keyword. Okay, so this is the general, I mean, most of the scenarios you will be going through this new keyword. There are certain instances or certain context where you will be using this class.furname. Okay, class.furname and new instance keyword. As I said, this just take down that this class.furname is a factory method. I will explain what exactly a factory method after this session. I mean, next section we will go through what exactly a factory method is and why we will use and where to use, what is the applications of a factory method and all those things, and why do we need to go for a factory method even though we have a new keyword. Okay, those are the, I mean, I will let you know that the difference of where to go and applicability of this factory method. And this is a clone method. Now you have a student st, you created an object st. Now again, if you want to have a student object, so they are using a this student object to clone. They are cloning this and it returns an object class, and we are typecasting here. This is called typecasting using student. Okay, the another method is deserialization. These are the four different ways of creating an object. So primarily we will concentrate, for the time being we will be using the first method to create an object. Next, methods. Okay, so in the employee class and also in the student class we have seen certain methods. So I was telling you that what exactly those are, like play in the student class, play, study, and all those things are called methods. And in the employee, work, report to superiors, monitor, and all those things are called methods. I was telling what exactly they are representing. I was saying that they are just nothing but the actions of a class, actions of a class. So in the same manner, now we are just going through what exactly that actions of a class means, and what exact, how do we define a method? What are the things that needs to be kept as a method? I mean, how do we define a method? What are the things that needs to be kept in a method? So according to the, again, Java docs, there is a certain definition for this method also. A method is just nothing but, in Java programming language, is a collection of statements that are grouped together to perform an operation. That's a very important statement. Okay, that are grouped together to perform an operation. Okay, a method is just nothing but, in a Java programming language, is a collection of statements which we do, which is a generic statement, but to specify what exactly it is different means, that are grouped together to perform an operation. Okay, so a method signifies a complete operation that is, it's going to be performed. Okay, it cannot be a set of statements only, but that set of statements signify that it completes an operation, complete operation. For example, I'm taking an example. Now, if I have a method over here, public int sum. Generally, if you see this function, I mean this method, public int sum, the name itself, generally in Java programming things, in the best practices is that while defining or while declaring your methods, you need to be very careful using their names. The names should signify what exactly the operation that is going to perform. You understood, right? The name should signify, the name of a method should signify the operation that is going to perform by this particular method. Now the name of the method is here sum. Now you know that sum is just the addition of numbers. So this method should add the numbers, whatever it takes. I mean, it should take some inputs and it should add them and return. Okay, this return is called your return type int. Okay, if I add two integers, the return type will be also in. So it should return this x plus 5. So when I call this method using even.sum, okay, it is expecting two parameters. Assume that I am giving some 2 and 3. So 10, some 10, 20. Okay. So the expectation is that this sum method should add this 10 and 20 and should return the value, which is 30. Okay. That should be the expectation of a this sum method. If not, if I say this, does that, is that statement correct? No, right? Because the expectation of this method while declaring or before writing this method, I will say that this method, this is called your comments. Okay, you know, I think you in the previous session, you have gone through what exactly the comments. Okay, this we will for readability purpose, for all those things, before writing a method, you will comment that what exactly the operation this particular method is going to do. I will say that this method, this method should perform addition of numbers. Okay, but whereas if you see this, this is a statement, there is nothing wrong with this method. Okay, this is value, this is valid and everything. Okay, but if you see this inside, it is not adding the numbers, but is returning whatever the numbers you give, it always returns one only. Okay, but it's not adding the numbers. So I cannot say that this is a method. So this statement, whatever the statement you have here that are grouped together to perform an operation is not valid in this case. Okay, in this case, it's not valid. So your method is just nothing but a set of or a collection of statements, but that are grouped to perform a particular operation. So that is a where your everything matters. So this defines how your method should be there, what exactly the method should perform. Okay, this is a basic definition of a method, and I showed you what exactly it is and how a method should perform. Now the things. Now we will go for declaration of a method. How do we declare and what are the different parameters of a, I mean, how do structure of a method and all those things, we will let go through that. Generally we will call it as a syntax. In Java we will call it as a method signature. Okay, this is method signature. Method signature is just nothing but syntax of a method. Now if you can see this example, public int sum, int x, int y, open braces and closed braces. In the middle, you said that set of statements, which is just nothing but your method body. Now, if you see this public int sum, public, as I said, that modifier, access modifier, whether it is accessible from everyone or whether there is a restrictions that needs to be put to access this method, that defines from the modifier. Now int. Okay, int defines the return type, means whenever you are calling this method, do you expect any return type? I mean, whether it gives an integer, whether it gives a double, or whether it gives a float, or whether it gives a string, or whether if it doesn't give anything, in that case we will be using void. Okay, void. Okay, now that is called return types. Now after that, sum is just nothing but name of the method. Now int x and int y are the parameters of a sum. Okay, this method. And in the middle, you will have a set of statements. Now we will go through what exactly that signature of a method means. I mean, now you can see this. See this. Public int sum, this is access specifier, I mean modifier. Okay, access modifier, this is your return type. The two param, we are adding two integers, so the return type will also be integer. So while writing the sum itself, I mean while writing the method itself, you know what exactly this method is going to return. Okay, so that's why I use it, the return type as int. Now after that, this is the sum is the name of the method. These are two the parameters of the method, and this return x and y, this statement is called the body of the method. Okay, now I will show some other things. Public string concat. Okay, this is another method where it returns a string. Okay, the return type of this concat method is string. Now I have another method which doesn't return anything. Then I will say public void work. Okay, this method doesn't return anything. Okay, already work is there, so it is showing error. So public void work one. So this work one method doesn't return anything, so that's why we are using the return type as a void. Okay, so you just understand, this is the return type of a method, this is the name of a method, and this is the statement of a return type, I mean statements of a method or body of a method, and these are the parameters that are being supplied to a method while invoking. Okay, if I am invoking this sum, right, you can see here, while invoking this sum I am supplying two parameters because it requests two, 10 and 20. What if I supply more? It will not accept. Okay, it will say, it will give some error. There is no such method which acts. There is no such method which is taking three parameters. You can see here. The method sum int int in the type employee is not applicable for the arguments int int int. Okay, it's not taking three parameters because it knows a method only which takes two parameters. Now if I reduce it to one, again it will also not take. Okay, it doesn't know the summation method which takes one parameter as a input. See, you can also see that it gives you the warning message. You can see this, the method sum int int in the type employee is not applicable for the arguments int. Okay, so it we need to provide how we declare. Okay, this is called method signature. Okay, this is called method signature. So while invoking a method also, you need to follow that method signature. You need to be in care, you need to take care. That's what I showed you just now. Okay, here the method is taking two parameters as an input. While invoking this method, I cannot supply three parameters or four parameters or no parameters. It will not identify. Okay, that is called invoking a method. This is called invoking a method. Object dot name, object dot method name is called invoking a method. So this is how you call the method. Next, I was just telling about you guys. Invoking a method, calling a method. How do I call class object dot method name? This is how it signifies. This is your E1 is just nothing but your object of class employee and method name dot method name. That's it. Now, does every time we require a object to invoke methods? No. What all methods do not require an object to be created? For example, if I have a method called public static void some cell. Now if you see this public static void cell, this one, This is an additional parameter or additional keyword. Now I am using in the method signature. I will let you know. I will let you know what exactly the static is. I think you people might have went all through this. What exactly the static keyword? Okay. Now if I see this. Now if you can see this. This is one method. Okay. This is how we invoke the method. Now we can also see this dot sorry. Okay. Static methods, invoking of static methods does not require even. I mean, invoking of static methods does not require objects. I will let you know why this is not required. Just for the time being, just take that invoking of static methods does not require objects. Okay, I will explain this static and all those things in the next session while explaining the Java runtime environment, Java virtualization things. Okay. This is a static method. How do we declare a static method is using keyword before the return type. Okay. So next method overloading. So what is a method overloading? So now assume that you can just see the definition. When a class has two or more methods by the same name, but different parameters, it is known as method overloading. Okay, if I use same methods sum and sum, then it is called method overloading. Okay, I am writing a method called sum, which returns an integer and which takes two integers as a inputs. Two parameters as an inputs. Okay. Now, this sum method takes two integers as a parameter and adds them and returns them. Okay, this is the return type. Now if I write the same method, if I write same summation method, it's same sum. Okay, and which returns, okay, now this particular sum method takes input as a integers. What if I need to do, if I want to supply two float numbers as an inputs, this method doesn't work here. Okay, because it summits only two integers, not doubles or not floats. So what I will do, I will write another method which adds two floats. This particular sum method is adding two float numbers. Then the return type of that, it will return only the float number. So the return type will also be float. This is called method overloading. Writing more than two methods with same name. The name of the method is same here, sum, but with different parameters. The parameters here is different types of parameters. The parameter here is integer. The parameters here is float. This phenomenon is called method overloading concept. Now, why we need to have a method overloading? we can have a separate method also, right? Because I cannot have a method called subtract for this, because it's also does the same operation. It also adds the two numbers, but they are different. They are float numbers. They are decimal numbers. Okay, but the type of inputs that it's going to submit are different from the integers. So for the readability purpose, to have more readability of the code, they have introduced method overloading. Java has introduced method overloading. So method overloading is just nothing but having two or more functions or methods with same name but with different parameters. Now how do we invoke them? We just invoke. Okay, so in this case you are supplying two integers, so it will execute the integer summation method. Okay, whereas in the next invocation e1 dot sum, I'm invoking float 10.1 2 3.6. we need to give explicitly f, otherwise it will take it as a double. Okay, now you are providing two float numbers as an input, then it will be invoking this method. Okay, this feature is called method overloading. This generally provides you more and more readability purpose. I can have an n number of summation methods which adds double, long and all those things. I can go for another two methods. In the same manner, in the programming also, you have a sum, you can have the same name for the method, but which takes a different inputs and give a different return type. Okay, for that purpose, they have introduced the method overloading concept. Okay, we will again discussing this method overloading in the polymorphism, okay, during overriding. So now constructor. What exactly is a constructor? Before going for a constructor is also a type of a method, is one of the type of a method. Okay, it is also one of the type of a method. A constructor is used in the creation of an object, that is an instance of a class. Typically it performs operations required to initialize the class before methods are invoked or fields are accessed, and constructors are never inherited. Okay, I will let you know what exactly a constructor in the programming. I was saying that a constructor is also a method. But constructor has certain writing a constructor, which is also a method, has certain conditions before writing a constructor. So what are those conditions? Constructors of a class must has same name as a class name in which it resides. Okay, this is the first condition. A constructor in Java cannot be abstract, final, static and synchronizing. Okay, we'll let you know what all these keywords means in the subsequent classes in different sections. What is mean by abstract, we will come to know this during inheritance, and the final keyword and static during packages, and synchronized during serialization, during threads, multi-threading concepts. So the second condition is that a constructor in Java cannot be abstract, final, static and synchronizing. Okay, access modifiers cannot be used in constructor declaration. I was telling you access modifiers, what exactly access modifiers are: public, private, protected and default are called access modifiers. Those cannot be used, access modifiers can be used in constructor declaration to control its access, that is which other class can call the constructor. So private, public, protected can be used as part of the constructor declaration. So if you can see, the first one is very, very important. Constructors of a class must has same name as the class name in which it resides. So we will follow this one. I said a constructor is just nothing but is one of the type of a method. So according to the first statement, constructor should have the same name of a class in which it resides. So the class, what is the class name of this employee? Okay, so I'm writing a constructor method. Okay, it should have the same name of a method. Okay, it should have the same name. Now, if you go for the second thing, a constructor in Java cannot be abstract, final, static, and synchronized. So I cannot use static here. Okay, because it doesn't allow. If I use static, it cannot be a constructor. But I can use a access modifier according to the third point. Access modifiers can be used in constructor declaration. So I can say for the time being, I'm using public employee. So this is called a constructor. This is called a constructor. Now, if you carefully observe this employee braces, I mean, closed brackets, you can also see here. This is the same method it is invoking, right? So what I can say here, during creation of an object, and a constructor will be called. Okay. According to the definition, if you see, a constructor is used in the creation of an object, that is an instance of a class. That's the reason we are using after new keyword employee this one. This is the syntax that we are using to create an object. So it means that this statement means that it is invoking this particular constructor to create an object. Okay. If I do not have this method, till now we do not have a method, this constructor, still we are getting the objects. It means that your JVM will create this method in your class. Okay. If you write explicitly, then it's good. If you do not write this constructor in your class, during object creation, during your class object creation, it will impart this constructor in your class. So that's a constructor is just nothing but it's a method which is called during the initialization of an object. Okay, that's a basic definition. Okay, so there is certain conditions that needs to be followed as part of a constructor. So first is that the name of the constructor should resemble the class name. Okay, its class name is employee, the name is also resembling. Okay, this is the first condition of a constructor. Next, we cannot use the keywords static, abstract, final, and synchronized before the declaration of a method in the constructor. We are not using, we are satisfying the second one also. Next, the third one is that we can use any access modifiers like private, public, and protected as part of the access modifiers of a constructor. So we are using public. Okay, then it is eligible to say this particular employee method as a constructor. Now, when these constructors will be invoked, at what time? You need not explicitly invoke this. If you need not explicitly invoke also, your JVM will invoke during the creation of an object. Okay, a default constructor or a constructor will be invoked during the object creation of a class. This is what you are signifying, this statement. Okay, this is invoking your, this is just nothing but internally this method will be invoked by the JVM. If it doesn't, your JVM will create a new constructor for this of type employee and it will invoke that method. Then what are the default different types of constructors are there? There are two types of constructors. One is default constructor and another one is parameterized constructor. So this is called default constructor. Default constructor is just nothing but which doesn't have any parameter to provide. A constructor that has no parameter is known as default constructor. If we don't define a constructor in a class, then compile, you can see this. That's what I was explaining. If we do not, if we don't define a constructor in a class, then compiler creates default constructor with no parameters for the class. And if we write a constructor with arguments or no argument, then compiler does not create a default constructor. Okay, this is what I was saying. Now you have this method, you have a constructor. Now when I execute this program, now the compiler will not create a new constructor for this because already a constructor has been explicitly written by the programmer. So the compiler will understand that already there is a constructor, so we need not create any constructor. Now, as I said, there are two types of constructors. One is the default constructor and the parameterized constructor. This is called default constructor. If we do not provide any inputs here, if I do not provide any parameters in the constructor, then it is called as a default constructor. For example, public employee. This particular method is called parameterized constructor. Okay, how does it differ from default constructor? Here I'm supplying two parameters. Okay, I'm supplying two parameters. Why do I need to supply? What is the purpose of a parameter constructor? That's where your applicability comes in of your parameterized constructor. Now, assuming that you know that in this employee or in this department, all the employees belongs to same department. Okay, all the employees belongs to same department and the age of the employees is also almost same, like 22 or 25. Okay, in that scenario I can go for a parameterized constructor. I will after this example you will come to know. Okay, now you can see this. I am creating an object E2. Okay, I am creating an object E2 and during the creation I am invoking this method. Okay, here if I invoke, I mean in this statement a default constructor will be called. Okay, in this statement, default constructor will be called. Whereas in the second statement, in this particular statement, in this statement, a parameterized constructor will be called. It means that during the creation of the initialization of the object itself, you are assigning certain values to certain fields. Okay. During the initialization itself, you are assigning the values, means you are assigning the department value and you are assigning the age value. Okay. This is the purpose of a parameterized constructor. If you want to initialize some of the properties or some of the parameters with certain values, then we need to go for a parameterized constructor. If you do not want to initialize anything, like instance, we will let you know what is the instance variables and all those things in detail. If you want to instantiate some instance variables during the creation of the objects itself, then we will go for a parameterized constructor. So that's advantage. If you do not want to initialize anything, then go for a default constructor. If you want to provide some during the initialization of the objects itself, you want to create something, I mean, you want to assign all the values to them, then you go for a parameterized constructor. That's a major difference between a default constructor and a parameterized constructor. Thank you.